Events allow you to write data on the blockchain. These data cannot later be retrieved by a smart contract. The main purpose of events is to log that something happened, so it can be a cheap alternative to storing your data as a state variable. If the data that you're going to be storing is something that you want to save on the blockchain once, and later on the smart contract does not have to retrieve it. We declare an event by typing event, and then followed by the name of the event. I'll name this event log, and inside the parentheses you declare the type of data that you're going to log. For example, we can log a type of string, and I'll name this message. We can also log another parameter. This time I'll log uint, and then name it val. The line above declared an event, so how do we log this event onto the blockchain? Well, we do by typing emit, and then followed by the event that we're going to be logging. For this example, we're going to be logging the log event, parentheses, and inside the parentheses, we put in the actual parameters. The first parameter is of type string, so for example, I can say foo. The second parameter is of type uint, so I'll say 1, 2, 3, 4. Notice that this function is declared not as a read-only function. This is a transactional function. And why is that? Well, it is because we're storing some new data onto the blockchain. We're logging the parameters foo and 1, 2, 3, 4 onto the blockchain. So this is why this function is not a read-only function. It is not a view or a peer function. It is a transactional function. If we execute this function, these two parameters will be stored on the blockchain. If you wanted to search for a particular event by the parameter that was logged, then we use the keyword index. Let me show you. So again, I'll declare this as event, and this time I'll name this indexed log. I want to filter this log by the first parameter, which will be an address. So we'll say indexed, and this name of the parameter, I'll name it sender. And for the second parameter, we'll log a uint again, val. To log this indexed log, we use the same syntax. So we say emit indexed log. This time the first parameter is an address, so I'll just put in an address, for example, message.sender. And for the value, I'll put in 789. Let's say that Alice calls this function 10 times, so message.sender will be Alice. Next, let's say that Bob calls this function 20 times, so that message.sender will be Bob now. Now, since we have the keyword indexed over here, instead of searching all of the logs for indexed log, and then filtering out for Alice, using Web3, we'll be able to quickly find all of the logs indexed log that was emitted by Alice. Since index allows you to quickly search for logs by the parameters, then you might want to put indexes on all of your parameters. However, you might not be able to do it. Up to 3 parameters can be indexed. If you're logging 4 parameters inside your event, you won't be able to put an index on all 4 parameters. You'll only be able to put on 3 of them. Let's look at another example. I'm going to build a chat using event. So I'll declare event. I'll name this message. This event will have 3 parameters. The address the message was sent from, the address the message is sent to, and the actual message. So we'll type address, and we'll declare as indexed, so that we can quickly search by the sender. And then I'll name this parameter underscore from. The next parameter is the receiver of the message, so I'll say address indexed, so that we can quickly search for the message by the receiver, underscore to, and the message, string message. We'll create a function called sendMessage. So I'll say function sendMessage. It's going to take in 2 parameters, the address to send the message to, and the string message that we're sending. So it'll be a string. String is a dynamic type, so I'll declare this as call data message. This function will be external. And inside this function, we'll send the message by typing emit message. From will be message.sender. To will be from the parameter. And the message will also be from the input. And now you have a smart contract where you can send anyone a message. This message will be public, meaning that anyone with access to the blockchain will be able to see your message. To send a message, you'll have to send a transaction. So you'll have to pay for every message that you send. This isn't the cheapest chat application to use, but using smart contract, it is possible.